Great, thank you. Thank you again. I'm sorry, but I should have said something about the use of this in 5G. Why I'm here? It's better, I mean, late than, I mean, nowhere. So, cooperation is, by evidence, one of the main techniques that are intended to be used actually in 5G. And it has already started in reality. In the fourth generation already, you have some elementary techniques, in fact, of cooperation that are utilized in the fourth G. What we actually do in WiMAX LTE, LTE Advanced, are the following things. Multi-antenna, most of the time, no more than four at transmitting and receiving sides. I know, for example, that for the WiMAX, I think it was, the WiMAX standard allows actually 2x2 transmissions. Every user equipment to utilize two antennas. Every transmitter to utilize two antennas. For the LTE, I think they go up to four. This is for the multi-antenna aspect. For cooperation, in the fourth generation cellular systems, standards allow actually relaying, but by base stations. So every base station is allowed to process the information that it gets to help the or to reinforce the signal that is transmitted by another base station. And of course, the standard does not define exactly what the base station that is relaying is supposed to do. But some elementary things that actually some of the industrial partners, including Qualcomm, whom I know, are doing, they are implementing actually physical layers using, for example, base stations that serve as relays for other base stations, employing amplifying forward. Well, you need nothing in that case, you just amplify, so you multiply by the power that you get. And it happens that, this can serve the users that are at the boundary of the cell. You know, there is this problem of what some people call the cell's boundary effect. The fact that if you don't use the relay as a base station, you should employ a huge amount of power to reach the guys who are far, away from the base station, at the boundary of the base station. If you are allowing another base station to relay your information, probably you can get the same thing, but at a low cost. The actual state of things is that relays are allowed in the fourth G to relay the information in the form of an amplified signal, amplifying forward. Some people, some industrial partners are using also decoded forward at some specified, what they call, central base stations. What is a central base station? The central base station is a base station that actually is more smart, let's say, than other base stations, and is equipped with calculation capabilities that are among average. And these base stations are allowed to decode the information. And decoding is done in its standard way. Just look at the closest point in the space. Maximum likelihood. Great. So the cooperation is also, of course, a candidate for the 5G, and more advanced techniques are allowed than this. Right? But of course, in any standard, it does not tell you how to do things exactly. If you are able to do, you are, allowed to. Great. The second part is entitled Cooperation in Places of Interference. So what I want to show you here is the fact that in places of interference, relays can play an important role in this type of on this type of networks, and they can do things that are different from they are what they usually are allowed to do in classic networks without interference. This is one point. The other point is that classic relaying techniques in a network in which there is interference actually do not help a lot, and we need to readjust. To adjust these techniques accordingly. What does it mean? It means to combine these techniques with some smarter techniques. And you will see actually a few examples of this. Guys, this is what I have said. So we will first start by trying to generalize the compress and forward scheme to networks. Remember that we presented that in the case of three-terminal network with one relay that is relaying, compressing and forwarding the information for one single destination. What happens if this actually is just a component of a big network? And if the information is to be actually reproduced at many destinations, not just one? And we will see in this aspect that there is a technique that is we'll see two things. We'll see that compress and forward as is does not work that good. But luckily, there is something else that is that utilizes the idea of compress and forward, but which works very well. And this is what we call noisy network coding. Right? And then there will be a subsection about relaying imprisons of an additive outside interference, and we will treat just highlight some cases. What we can do in the case in which this interference, which is interfering everybody, the relay and the destination, is not known at all. What role can do the relay in that case? What role the relay can case if it knows partially the interference? What role the relay can do if, it should serve a source that knows partially the interference? And we'll see that in the two cases, the techniques are completely different. And then we'll try, if I have some time, to connect with what we call channels with the states, which is something more important. Great. So remember that we had in the case of one single destination, this network that is here, a source, a destination, a relay, which is the receiving Y2, compressing it and transmitting it to a certain destination. And we remember also that what we have said that at the end of the first part, the fact that compress and forward, although it's not optimal all the time, sometimes it can be, it can be performed by decode and forward. It has the advantage that it does not necessitate the utilization of CSIT. When you only compress as you relay, you don't need anything. Even though you don't know the CSI, that's okay. However, decode and forward, as we have seen, is good, but necessitates CSIT for the coherence combining of the signal, which, as I said, most of the time is not the case for the CSIT. So in those cases, compress and forward is maybe a good candidate. Right? The problem is the fact that when you try to generalize compress and forward to networks, you are back to a solid problem. What is the solid problem? To see this, just consider the case in which the relay quantize and transmit the signal, and that signal to be utilized by two separate destinations. That's a very simple case. Great. If the relay were dedicated only to help this destination, well, it does exactly what we have described before. It quantizes the signal that it gets using the output of that destination outside information, and we have this as the rate. We have discussed that case. If it were dedicated only to help this, well, it quantizes this using this output outside information. Right? This is what I call Wiener-Zinni code. Now, what about if it were dedicated to help both at the same time, simultaneously? Well, this is a very big problem, because I cannot take the two at the same time as side information, because what is available at one side as side information is not available at the other. Well, what we can do in that case, but this is suboptimal, is to try to, as a relay, to produce two descriptions, two versions of compressions with different distortions, one that is to be utilized here and one that is utilized here. But this is the suboptimal. And the problem, another problem with this is the fact that when your network contains many nodes, well, you should divide into, many descriptions. And even to analyze this scheme, it becomes extremely difficult. Right? So actually, this small network with only two destinations points us out to one of the main limitations of compress and forward in networks. I mean, compress and forward in its standard form, containing using the side information of one specific decoder as side information. This is a direct consequence of the fact that as a relay, when I'm quantizing, I should know where what I'm quantizing is to be utilized. And they should utilize aside information the output of that decoder, that specified decoder. And they cannot utilize two or more at the same time. So there's a big problem. Luckily, there's an alternative technique that actually is based on the same, or more or less the same idea, and consists in doing compression, but in a smarter way. So here, every relay in the network will just perform standard compression, not taking into account any side information, forgetting about everything, but with two major differences. One is that every message will be transmitted not only one time, but several times. Right? And the second is the fact that every decoder in the network will be decoding not only using one block, but actually using all blocks together, which makes sense because every information is sent in every block. It's a bit complicated to process this, to analyze this scheme, and that's why I'm skipping the proof. But actually, this can be shown to perform the following. In the case of just one network, one relay channel, it does exactly the same thing as compress and forward. But it has the advantage that it scales appropriately. What does it mean? It means that if I have a network with n nodes, I can just compress the same way I'm compressing if it were just a three-node network. Do exactly the same thing, and it's the job of every receiver, in that case, to perform the decoding appropriately in such a way that it gets the appropriate thing it should get. Right? So let me skip this. Great. Just to illustrate how much this is strong, let's take this simple example. I have an encoder which communicates with a decoder, encoder one with decoder one, but in presence of another pair of transmitter receiver that communicate over the same medium. So we have, of course, interference here over this channel. This is called an interference channel, for those who don't know. Great. In addition, here I will assume that I have feedbacks from both receivers to the respective transmitters. But these feedbacks are intermittent. What does it mean? It means that the feedback arrives only at certain times, not at others. Probably because the channel, changes. And there are times in which, the information is lost. Feedback information is lost, so it does not arrive. The transmitters do not know exactly when the information will, feedback information will be there, when the information will be there, and when it will not be there. They don't know that. We call this an intermittent feedback, right? So at time I, this transmitter gets feedback with, say, some probability when the channel permits it, and it gets an erasure, that is to say, it does not get feedback, with the complement of probability, 1 minus p1. The same happens for the second. And the erasure events may be correlated because they describe the same chunk, right? Of course, I can model this using some, Bernoulli states like this. This is not important. So the question is, as transmitters, how can we use that feedback information to boost the capacity of the network? Why this question is reasonable? Intuitively, every information that I receive as a transmitter may be utilized or may be useful for both receivers at the same time. In the case of perfect feedback, that is to say, if the feedback were available all the time, not in an intermittent way, what people do in general is that they set the transmitters to try to decode the information that is in the feedback signal and then retransmit it. For example, at transmitter one, I'm receiving a feedback. Suppose that I get it all the time. That feedback information may contain information about what the other guy is sending. So I get to know what the other guy is sending. That is to say, I get to know a sense about the interference, and that's important. So I can do something with it, right? So in that case, partial decode and forward schemes, can be utilized. They are not optimal, but they can be utilized, and it's reasonable to employ them. The problem with intermittent feedback is that if you insist to decode, well, you can constrain the rate, to be very low, because you can insist to decode from nothing, and then, of course, everything is lost. So it makes sense in this case to just compress, because you are not able to decode as transmitters. The feedback does not arrive all the time. You cannot decode. The information is lost. So in that case, it makes most sense to just compress and send. The problem is that what you compress should be utilized at two destinations. And that with the compress and forward, regular compress and forward cannot be done in appropriate way because of that side information problem, which side information to take. So, but you can do it using the noisy network compression technique. And actually it performs very well. It turns out that this is the best thing to do among all others, better than amplifying and forward, better than decoding and forward, and better than compressing and forward to just one of the two. I'm skipping the details, but you can find some of which here in this reference. It turns out that this is optimal for this case. We call this the linear deterministic interference channel, and it's also optimal for another class, which is a bit more general, which is called the Costa-Gamal injective deterministic IC, but let me just skip that part. Okay, so what to retain from what I have said is the following. Compress and forward has a problem in big networks because of that problem of which side information to utilize. Luckily, there is something that corrects that. Noisy network coding, which is based on the same idea, compressing and forward, but the compression is done in a standard way, not taking into account any side information, and the decoders do the job in a more comparatively more smarter way, and things work very well. And that technique we call it noisy network coding, compressing a la noisy network coding. That's what to retain from that. Great. Let's now move to another aspect. Suppose that we have the same network, relay network, and there is an outside interferer, the guy which is a red. Right? And the guy is sending things that actually interfere with everybody. It corrupts the signal to the relay, and it corrupts the signal to the destination. Right? Suppose that what the interferer sends has some power, Q. The HUV here are the channel coefficients, right? And nobody knows what the interference sends in this case. What can I do as a relay? Well, you can always try to do the classic techniques that I described in the first part. But it happens that actually, if the interferer is strong, if he is sending with a big power, whatever you do will be, will perform only little. Poor. Why? Because you can try to amplify the signal from the source, but it would get lost. I mean, in the information, in the noise. I mean, that is injected by the interferer. Right? You can try to decode, but because of this, if this is strong, you won't be able to decode. You can try to compress and forward, but because the interference is strong, you are just compressing noise, and that's bad. It turns out that a more intelligent way to do for the relay is, even though it does not know the interference, to relay the interference. It's not really intuitive, because there is an interference, you are not combating it. The best way to do is to reinforce it. Not completely intuitive, as I said, but it turns out that this works. The reason for which it works is the following. What the guy is injecting is not noise, actually. That's a code word, so it has a structure. So it's decodable. And this is where exactly interference is different from noise. It has a structure, so it can be decoded. When you amplify as a relay the interference, you make it stronger. So it will appear stronger at the destination. So it will be more decodable at the destination, even though the destination is not required to decode the interference. But it can do it. And because the interference is strong, the destination will be doing it, or will be able to do it, with almost no cost, because it's very strong. And once it decodes it, it gets rid of it just by canceling its effect, performing the MIMS operation, decode the information, then X4, then you retrieve it, and then you get something free of interference from which you decode the information from the source. Right? So here, interference actually is, the best way to do is not to combat the interference, but rather to amplify it, which is counterintuitive, but performs better than any other classic technique. Great. The reason for which this works actually, or the rationale behind this, is the following. If you take an interference channel like this, this guy is communicating with this guy in presence of another guy who is communicating with another guy and who is hurting you. He's causing interference for you. This is, as I said, is an interference channel. The capacity of which is not known, but is known actually in some extreme regimes. One of the regimes in which the capacity region actually is known is what we call the strong interference regime. What does it mean? It means that at the first receiver, the interference appears, way stronger than the information message from the respective encoder. The interference is stronger than the signal that carry the true signal. In that case, we know the capacity region, and it turns out that the best thing to do is precisely to decode first the interference, though you are not required to decode. But because you are able to decode it, you do it, then you get rid of it, you cancel its effect, and you can decode your information completely interference free of cost, which is a very good thing. Well, we also know this is out of the scope of this part of the talk, but we also know the capacity of this channel in the very weak interference. In the case in which the guy who is hurting you is actually transmitting with a very low power, it turns out that the optimal thing is to ignore it, because he does not hurt much, just treat it as noise. But when he hurts a lot, the best thing to do is to decode what the guy is sending, even though you are not interested or are not required to do it. But because you are, again, able to decode it, you get rid of it and you get your information free of cost. Now, that was the case in which nobody knows the interference. What about the case in which the interference is known partially? It happens that actually the best thing to do by the relay is completely different. And actually, it even depends on the way the relay knows the interference. Well, I will say that a node in general, be it 1, 2, or 3, knows the interference strictly causally if at time I, it knows everything that the interferer has sent up to time I minus 1. I know it strictly causally. I know it causally if I know at time I everything that the relay has, the interferer has sent up to and including time I. Right? Non-causally, I know it non-causally if I even know what the guy will be transmitting in the future. There are some cases, of course, I mean the most, maybe the most practical, assumption is the first one. This is more reasonable, but there exist also, I mean, situations in which you can know the interference beforehand, in advance. Suppose you are the relay, and you are helping this guy to transmit with, its's information to this guy, but you also transmit something else to someone else. What you transmit to that other guy, you know it non-causally, and actually is interference in the eyes of this guy. So that's the case in which you know the interference non-causally. So it's not really out of sense to assume that in certain cases, you may know the interference even non-causally. Great. So in what follows, I will be just giving, I mean, some or discussing some examples of this without delving into the details of it. Right. Now let me recall just one thing, because I will be needing it in what follows. I will be back in a moment to our relay network. But just take one point-to-point network with the sender that transmits a signal X to a destination that receives a signal Y. That signal gets corrupted by two things. One interferer who sends S and standard noise Z. Suppose the noise has variance N and the interferer is sending with power Q. Assume also that the interferer knows everything that the guy is transmitting. Can it cancel its effect? So you are the transmitter. You know what the guy hurting you is transmitting beforehand. Can you cancel the effect of that guy? Yes. Independently on what the guy is sending. And again, this may appear intuitive, but it's not. Why? Because the guy may be transmitting with a huge power, and you cannot just send X minus S. Because X minus S would require a lot of power, and you may actually not have that power. So the optimal thing to do is not to send X minus S. Actually, it's to do what we call dirty paper coding. What is dirty paper coding? This is a kind of pre-coding. So what you send is a signal U minus alpha S. U is some auxiliary signal. I will tell you in a moment how you choose it. Minus alpha S. And you can choose the alpha in such a way that the power of U minus S is exactly the power that you have at your disposal, just by choosing the appropriate alpha. Right? And it happens that the appropriate choice of alpha is P divided by P plus N. And by doing that, you will send U minus alpha S with an appropriate choice of U. It gets corrupted by S plus Z. So what the receiver will get is U minus alpha S plus N. That is to say, U plus 1 minus alpha S all times S plus N. Because alpha is P divided by P plus N, the power at which the transmitter transmits divided by that power plus N, 1 minus alpha, when the SNR becomes large, goes to zero, and so the decoder will get is U plus N plus some epsilon that comes from that 1 minus alpha, and U is the signal that is of interest. That's why you get rid of S. And that's why precoding works. And you get exactly the same capacity, log of 1 plus SNR, as if the interferer were not there. It's not intuitive. This is one of the most cited papers in information theory. A 3-page paper by Costa. So that's called writing on dirty paper, right? Or dirty paper coding. And actually, because at the time it was done, it's not intuitive at all to come up with such a technique. But it happens that this is very important. In particular, I mean, in a lot of situations, broadcasting situations, it turns out to be useful. Well, now, back to our relay network. Suppose that we have exactly the same thing. A transmitter is transmitting to a destination through a relay, and there is an interferer who sends us something. Suppose that that thing is known by both the source and the relay. Can it be cancelled completely? Just a reference to what Costa does. Yes, it can. In that case, I mean, just do things in appropriate manner. You get what you call cooperative dirty paper coding between the source and the relay, and you get rid completely of the interference. So if you are employing a relay to send to a destination in presence of a guy who is bothering you, if both you and the relay know everything that the guy is transmitting, you can coordinate in such a way that you completely cancel the effect of the other guy. Right? Great. Problems start when only one of the guys knows the interference. These are called asymmetric models. Asymmetric in the sense that only one of the source and the relay knows the interference. In that case, actually, interference cancellation is not possible. By no means you will be able to completely cancel the effect of the interference. Why? To see it, one easy way to see it is compare it with what happens if there were no interference at all. Remember that if there were no interference, for example, if the relay is employing decode and forward, the two guys, the key element that makes it work, that makes decode and forward work, is the fact that the two guys can, at the same time, when I say the two guys, I mean the source and the relay. The thing that makes it work is the fact that the source and the relay transmit at every time instant two things that are correlated, two signals that are correlated. In presence of an interference that only the relay knows, this is not possible. Why? Because the relay, of course, should utilize the knowledge that he has about the interference, that is to say, it should send a signal that depends on not only what it has received from the source, but also from, that should depend on the interference. But when it does that, there's no way for the source to know what the guy is sending, because the source does not know the interference, so it cannot know the function of the interference, simply. So you cannot do the decode and forward this way. And so complete interference mitigation is not possible. Now that we know that it's not possible, can we do something, just to cancel partially its effect? Yes. What the relay can do in this case is to divide its symbol or code word into two parts. One part for the design of which it will not utilize the knowledge of the interference. Even though it knows the interference, for the design of that specific part, it will ignore it. That part, I'm calling it U1. For the design of the other part, however, it will utilize the knowledge of the interference. And it sends the superposition of the two. In the Gaussian case, this comes back to the addition of the two. Right? Of course, designed appropriately. Why the first part is chosen or should be chosen independently from the interference, even though you know the interference? Well, that's because that would permit you to create correlation or that famous coherent combining with the source, and that's good. Because that part of the signal does not depend on the interference, the source can know it in advance. And so it can conceive its good word in a way to be correlated to that. The other part can exploit the knowledge of the interference just by doing some kind of generalized dirty paper code. And if you do that, you obtain famous things. For example, you can show that this this rate is achievable. We can do this. Of course, well, I'm not going to go through the details of this, but the only thing to observe is the fact that there is a queue somewhere. There's no way to get rid completely of the interference. But we do way better than ignoring it or treating it as noise. Great, let me skip this. And there are cases in which actually that way of dividing the code word into two pieces, one that is intended to create correlation and another one to exploit the interference, to be optimal. If the noise at the relay is bigger than a certain threshold, it turns out to be the optimal thing. There are other cases actually in which this is optimal. For example, when the interference is arbitrarily strong, when Q goes to infinity, that is the best thing to do. That way of dividing the code word into two pieces turns out to be the optimal thing. That's also, optimal in certain extreme cases, but let me skip this. There is one important special case that I usually want to show. This is what I call the diff-helper problem. What is the diff-helper problem? You are using a relay to help you transmit your information to someone. There is an interferer. Only the relay knows the interferer. But it happens that the relay is not able to hear you at all. The relay is deaf. Sourd, en français. Can the relay help you get rid of the interference? Yes. Although the relay does not hear at all what you are transmitting, it can cancel the interference for you. This, again, is not intuitive. But this is possible. You can transmit as if there were no interference at log of 1 plus SNR. Right? Let me skip the details of how this is done. Of course, I can comment about this for those who are interested. Now, let me show you, for example, one curve that depicts what's happening. I'm giving here the rate versus the SNR between the source and the relay. Right? The SNR is increasing from 0 to 30 dB. The curve here is what I obtain if the relay is completely ignoring the interference and doing regular decode and forward, classic technique. This rate, it grows this way. Q here is equal to 10 dB. Right? This is what happens, the blue curve, with the technique that I have mentioned, which is way better, of course. And actually, it turns out even to be optimal. The dashed curve in red here is an outer bound that we developed for that case, and which I did not describe because of lack of time. So it happens that it turns out that technique of ignoring the interference for conceiving one part of the code word and utilizing it for conceiving another part is optimal above a certain SNR. And it's also optimal below a certain SNR. There's only very small region in which it's not optimal, but actually the two curves are very, very close one to another. This is an outer bound. Well, again, because I had a comment about this, an outer bound is something that tells you that whatever you do, by no means you will exceed that thing, that rate. So here, whatever the relay does, the rate should not exceed this curve. And by what I described, it does, the blue curve, which is very close. So it's almost optimal, actually. Great. What about the situation in which now the source knows the interference? So again, what is the scenario? You are the transmitter, transmitting to a certain destination, utilizing one relay node in presence of an interference. You, as a transmitter, know the interference, but not the relay who is helping you. He does not know the interference. what is the optimal thing to do? Right? Well, what we can do, there are different techniques that can be employed for this. For example, I can, as a source, I can try to obtain or to figure out what the relay would send had it known the interference. Right? And then reveal to the relay just, reveal that thing to the relay. What does it mean? It means I compute in advance what the relay would send had it known the interference, and then transmit it to the relay and ask him to retransmit it. Right? I know what the guy should do had it known the interference, so I can do it at his place because I know the interference, and then transmit to the relay what it should have sent had it known the interference. It will cost some power to transmit that thing to the relay, but it's an interesting idea to do. And what I can do also is describe the interference to the relay. What does it mean? I don't utilize all my power to send information messages. I utilize part of my power to describe the interference for the relay. I quantize the interference, send it to the relay, and then the relay can utilize that compressed version of the interference to send to the destination. Let me skip the details of these because these are a bit tedious. And actually, they make appeal of utilization of certain advanced techniques, which maybe not everybody is well acquainted with. So let me just show you a figure which actually depicts what's happening. So I'm giving here the rate across the S and R source to relay. Right? This is an outer bound. Red color, it means that by no means you can exceed that, whatever you do. Right? The curve that is in blue is what I obtain as a rate if the source is doing, local processing, and then send to the relay just what the relay would have sent had it known the interference. The other curve is the other idea, or corresponding to the other idea. I describe the interference to the relay, and then I let him do, at his position, the processing. I tell him the interference is such or such, and then manage to send what is appropriate. And this is what I call distributed processing. You know the interference, you describe it to the relay, and then the relay does some processing, and so the two are distributed, especially, and then we obtain this. The other way is what I call local processing. What does it mean, local processing? That is, because you know the interference as a source, you do everything, and then you send to the relay the appropriate thing that he should send had it known the interference. As if you are communicating, or you were communicating with an oblivious relay. Oblivious relaying is utilizing a relay who does not think a lot. So you do everything, and then you tell him, just do what I'm asking you to do. Huh? And the source can be smarter because the source knows the interference. Great. What I described up to now actually connected with the more general idea of what is called relaying in presence of state information. What is a state information? A state information is any information about the network that some of the guys in the network can know and some others know. Right? Any information. It could be, for example, an information about the fading coefficients, the CSI, an interferer, like the example that I have presented. Anything. right? The activity, for example, the mobility inside the network, any information, absolutely any information in the network. I call it S in an abstract form. And then we can treat two cases. The case in which that information, arbitrarily information about the network, is known only at the relay, what kind of things we can do? Again, what I described is the case in which S is an interferer. Right? That's just one possible case. I mean that theory is way more general. We can, analyze this, and I think this is done here. This is a work that I did with Nick Landman, maybe some of you know. Nicolas Landman from University of Notre Dame. So you can find a lot of information here. The other case is the case in which the state, again, that can be more general than just an interferer, is known at the source. And you can find some information, about this in some other papers that are references of which are given here. Great. Let me now just connect, with one specific case, and maybe we'll conclude in a few slides about this. How much time do I have now? Remaining time. That's five. Great. Well, that's because I have skipped a lot of things, but maybe that was not too bad. great. This also is a very interesting case. Well, suppose now that the information about the channel is known only in a strictly causal manner in the network, which, as I said in the beginning, is more realistic. Why? Suppose that these two guys communicate with a common destination. So we have a MAC problem, first encoder, second encoder communicating with a guy. The two guys have in common a message to send to that destination, and in addition, this guy, encoder one, also has another message to transmit to the same destination. This is what we call it, a MAC with degraded message sets. The reason for which I'm presenting this in a tutorial in which I'm talking about relaying is the fact when actually your relay does decode and forward, you are back exactly to this situation. Because the guy, when he does decode and forward or partial decode and forward, it comes to know what you are transmitting as a source. So this guy here plays the role of a relay because it can know a piece of the information you are transmitting. So, algebraically, it can be modeled this way. Anyway, that was just to make the connection. But you can make it you can take it as a different model that we will be discussing here. So these two guys are communicating with this guy. The two guys are transmitting a common message, and in addition, this guy is transmitting a separate message, W1. And there is some information about the channel that I'm denoting by S that is available in a non-causal manner, in a strictly causal manner here, at both source and relay. One realistic situation in which this happens is the following. Imagine that this is only a piece of a big network, and actually the two guys do communicate with this guy, but also serve as relays for another guy. So the two nodes here serve as a relay or as relays for another guy. If they are performing, both of them decode and forward, they will get to know exactly what the guy is sending, strictly causally, of course. But what that guy is sending is interference in the eyes of this guy. But that interference is particular or is specific in the case that it is known strictly causally at the two encoders. So can we manage to get it, cancel it? This is the question we're asking. Great, that's almost everything. Well, what we show here is the formula. We show that actually it is indeed I mean, the knowledge of the state, which again can be interference, you can think of it as being an interference, the S here, known strictly causally as the two guys. The knowledge of that state strictly causally, or only strictly causally as the two guys, is indeed beneficial. It means that there is a way that the two guys, I mean, in which the two guys can exploit their knowledge about the state to increase the capacity of the channel. Here, I mean, I want to attract your attention on the fact that this is not obvious at all. Why? Because, I mean, as transmitters, you get to know the interference, but only after the damage is done, only strictly causally. The guy is transmitting, is causing interference, and you get to know it, or you come to know it, only afterhand. It's not, I mean, evident, or it's not easy to see whether that, I mean, coming to know afterwards can still be exploited in a clever manner. It turns out that indeed this is possible. And it is indeed beneficial that actually the two guys can know the interference in strictly, or the state in general, in a strictly causal manner. That knowledge, even afterhand, can increase the capacity. This is done here. You can find a lot of information about that. Great. The basic idea or the scheme which can be utilized in this is the following. As transmitters, As transmitters, what the source and the relay can do is the following. They can actually quantize everything that they know, even afterwards, and send it to the destination. And the destination will manage to make it work. Right? Managing to making it work means the following. It will actually not decode, I mean, on live, but it will do what we call backward decoding. Because it knows that the guys will be sending something afterwards, it will wait until it gets everything, and knowing, I mean, the compressed version of this the channel, at each time block, the destination can utilize it as an output, because it gets it from the quantized version that the two guys are sending. Now I want to make a connection with something probably some of you or most of you know. Well, that's what we call Madda-Halitzsche scheme. How many one of you knows this? I guess Tariq, of course. I mean, Madda-Halitzsche scheme. David Chay. This is interference alignment scheme. The idea is exactly the same. Aligning the interference in such a way that it gets decodable actually. You align the interference in such a way that the guy can get rid of it. Or the two guys actually in the interference channel can both get rid of it. Here it amounts basically exactly to the same thing. Remember that the S minus 1 here, I minus 1, is a kind of, as I said, strictly causal or an interference that you come to know afterwards. What you do is you compress what you get, what you come to know, and then send it. But by doing that, what actually are doing is aligning the interferences in the case in which S represents interference. So, but this is more general because this work is for any channel, and S is not required to be an interference. It can be anything. Great. Well, it connects also with many other works that are recent in this domain. And it happens that this is optimal in certain cases. For example, in the case in which S, which is the state of the channel, is a function of the inputs and the output, which precisely the case when S stands for an interference. Because you get Y, which is X1 plus X2 plus S plus, and when S is interference, so S is a function of X1, X2, Y. It happens that this is the best thing to do. So the best thing to do that is that you can tie the interference even though you come to know it only afterwards. Quantize and send, and the get will manage to get it. I mean, the guy at the destination will manage to get it utilized in the appropriate form. And the best thing, the capacity region, I mean, the best thing that you can have is given or described by this. In the Gaussian case, for example, when S is an interference, the two guys are transmitting X1 and X2, get interfered with S. S is known to the two guys in a strictly causal manner. The maximum same rate that at which the two guys can transmit is given by this. And no other relaying techniques will give you something better than this, because this is the capacity. So the best thing to do, again, is to compress that thing, which is or can be interpreted, as I said, as a form of MAT scheme, Madalice scheme, interference alignment. Great. But delayed state or delayed CSI does not always help. There are cases in which it does not help. When you come to know an information about the channel, but only afterwards, only when the damage is done, there are situations in which that's too late. Does not help at all. Well, one of the cases, well, it does not help in any situation, it does not help in any situation for the sum rate. Well, this is one thing. The other thing is when the delayed CSI is known only at the guy who sends the two messages, the source, that's not beneficial. So you have a source, a relay, and the destination, an interferer. The source gets to know or comes to know the interference only strictly causally, only afterwards, only after the damage is done. Nothing to do with that knowledge. Just throw it down. It does not help at all. However, when the relay comes to know that, it is indeed helpful. And this is, I don't know whether I mentioned that, no, but yeah. Good to know, when it is the relay who comes to know the interference, even if it is strictly causally, it is still beneficial. The relay can still help you. The idea is the same. The relay can compress what it gets, transmit it, and the destination will manage to get not rid fully of the interference, but get rid of a part of the interference. Now, the question is why it does not work with the source. The problem is that when the source does that, the source will utilize a part of its power to do that. And that part then won't be utilized to send information, message information. So at the cost of sending, new message, you send a compressed version of the interference. It turns out that this is not beneficial when you are the source. But when you are the relay, this is beneficial. Why? Because the relay, as a relay anyway, you don't know the message. So your power can indeed be utilized to do this. Great. I'm almost done. Let me just say a few words about something that I call interaction and computation. What is this? This is something, as I said in the beginning, which seems completely different from cooperative communication, but actually is connected. So suppose that you have two guys here. The first guy observes a certain source that I'm denoting by X, and the second observes a certain source that I'm denoting by Y. Right? Now, what this guy wants us to do is to compute a function of X and Y. X that it knows and Y that it does not know. What the other guy wants us to do is to compute a function, another function, of X and Y. Right? So every guy is interested in a function of the two sources, and every guy knows only one of the sources. So what the two guys will do is to try to interact by sending messages. This is a source coding problem, because this is a source. You should code it, transmit it to the, in an appropriate way, transmit it to the other guy in such a way that the other guy will be able to compute a certain function that he wants to obtain. He is required to do the same thing. So you should interact. I'm calling MI the message that every guy should transmit in time I. For example, if this senders at time I, he transmits message M1, the other guy transmits M2, etc. The question is, interaction, which is some form of cooperation here, is it helpful to compute functions? Well, the answer is not that evident. I'm skipping here a lot of details, but let me just say one thing. Well, yeah, so the questions that we ask are, as I said, is interaction useful? Does it make sense, I mean, to interact during a certain time? Here, T rounds of interaction. Does it make me, compute in a better way my function and make at the same time the other guy compute his function in a better way? The answer is not easy. By how much it is useful? And what is the best? What is the best way to interact? Great. Let me recall the basic setup in which the first guy knows the source X, the second knows the source Y, and only the second guy is required to compute a very specific function of X and Y, which is X. This is what you call source reproduction. Losslessly, because this guy is interested in X, precisely in X, not a distorted version of X. Well, it happens that in this case, it does not actually, well, before I say this, maybe it makes sense that I add this, the following thing. When the interaction takes place in one shot, that is to say, only one time, I know that from some rate distortion theory quantization again with side information, that the minimum number of bits that I should send to that guy is such that, he learns X is the entropy of X given Y. This is what is called Slippian Wolf coding. And this is compression, actually. You compress, but without a distortion. So you have you should utilize this many number of bits. If you utilize one round. Now, the question is, does it make sense to utilize many rounds? It turns out that actually does not, it won't help you any further to do that, to interact. If that guy is interested in getting precisely X, not a function of X, this is a very specific case, X. It does not help to interact. Better communicate in one shot, and that's the optimal thing to do. Now, when one of the two guys or both of them are interested in reproducing the sources, but this time with distortion, that's why I'm utilizing the hat notation. So this guy is interested in getting Y hat, and the other guy is interested in getting X hat. In this case, it's different. It is indeed useful to interact. Interaction helps in this case. And the best thing to do is that every time you use, the Wiener-Zipf compression that I have mentioned in the beginning, that is to say you compress, utilizing the fact that the other guy has some side information or an information correlated to what you are compressing. So, for example, for the first round, I'm compressing X, knowing that the guy has some knowledge Y, which is correlated to my X. So the number of bits I need is this. Right? He should reply by sending a compressed version of everything he knows up to that moment, taking into account that I do know things that are correlated to what he knows. And that would actually cost this many number of bits. The essential thing to retain here is the fact that by opposition to the lossless case, interaction does help in this case. Now, what about computing functions? Yeah, of course, I mean, it does help because, I mean, the case of source reproduction with distortion is a specific case, the case in which fx is equal y hat and a fy is equal x hat. So it is useful, but I mean, there are ways to characterize for a T-round protocol the minimum number of bits that the two guys would need to exchange so that everybody gets to compute the function in which it is interested. And that interaction does help again. I think I'm done, so let me just wrap up. So I hope that you are now convinced or more convinced for those who are well acquainted with this, that there are many approaches, benefits, and challenges also, because we have seen a number of problems also that are still open to solve, to utilizing relay and cooperative communication networks. That network counting and multi-hop actually are specific cases of relaying. Relaying is more general, right? I'm saying this because some people may say I'm working on network counting but not on relaying. Simply because they are doing or use it to do network counting in layer 2 on bits. So they think, or they may think, that this is completely different of relaying. But this is one specific case of doing actually relaying. And I think we have shown this. That the theory is, or the capacity is difficult to analyze in general. We don't know for a relay channel what is the best thing to do. But luckily, we do know things that are smart enough to actually solve a number of cases. And the theory here is incredibly, as I said, flexible and diverse. Generalization to networks is not easy. That's a subtle thing. So relaying in a big network with M nodes, it's not as easy as it appears, except maybe amplifying forward because you don't need nothing. But the other two, decode and forward and compress and forward, do pose actually some challenges. Luckily, for compress and forward, there is a way to turn it around, I mean, and solve the problem. And this is what I described about the noisy network coding scheme, which is a form of compressing and forwarding.